Welcome back to the course Physics and Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium. Today we have lecture number 4. In the previous lectures, we introduced the hydrodynamic and the magnetohydrodynamic equations. And today we will talk about a few consequences for the motion and the kinematic state of the interstellar medium. We will start by looking at unstable and stable conditions for the interstellar medium. What are instabilities that might occur under certain circumstances? And in the second part, we will take a closer look at turbulent motion that arises from compressibility conditions of the interstellar medium. How does perturbations that are introduced on a large scale into the medium then are transferred down to smaller scales? What does this mean for observable properties of the interstellar medium? And this is the part 3 on turbulence theory and part 4 on turbulent observations. So let's start by looking at instabilities, and we will first look at gravitational instability called Jeans instability. We are looking at the pure hydrodynamic case, so we neglect any magnetic field terms, we neglect any current terms from our equation, and we will study the instability by performing a perturbation analysis for a smooth medium. This means we have the following assumptions. We have, for simplicity, an infinitely extended medium. So at any point in this medium, gravitation from any direction cancels out in this very smooth medium. We have a constant density, rho naught. And we assume that our medium is at rest, so that this medium has zero velocity. So this is our initial assumption, the initial setup of our medium. And we want now to evaluate how small density perturbations, rho 1, evolve in our medium. We make the assumption that rho 1 is much smaller than our overall mean density, rho naught. And we are interested in the evolution, the changes of the density with time, which basically boil down as how the perturbation density, rho 1, changes with time. And this gives also rise to a velocity of this perturbation, velocity 1. Our small perturbations will not produce very large velocity gradients, so we will look at the partial derivatives of the velocity, and we ignore friction terms because we will not have large shear motion or anything compared. When we now look at our simplified hydrodynamic equations, so the equations 1 to 4 that we introduced in the previous sections, we have the Navier-Stokes equation that describes, this is basically the hydrodynamic equivalent of Newton's equation, so where we describe how the velocity of a fluid element changes as a consequence of some gravitational potential that is acting on the fluid element, described here by the first term minus rho times the gradient of the gravitational potential. And we have a second term, the negative gradient of the pressure field that is also acting as a force on our fluid element. The perturbation that we introduce is an addition to our smooth density gradient, to our smooth density, and therefore any pressure effect comes from our perturbation. We have no large scale flow, so the general velocity changes can be described here as the partial derivative locally of the velocity, and the rho naught, the mean density, determines the overall scaling factor. So our Navier-Stokes equation can be written as the partial derivative of our velocity as being the negative gradient of the gravitational potential minus the scaled pressure gradient negative. The Poisson equation gives the effect of our density perturbations on the gravitational potential, so that the second derivative of the gravitational potential is 4 pi, the gravitational constant, times the density of our perturbation, because only those contribute to changes, spatial changes in the gravitational potential. The gravitational potential of the mean density is homogeneous, so the derivatives, of course, are zero. And due to the infinitely extended medium, this gives a constant term. As a third equation, we have the continuity equation. And again, our rho naught mean density can be introduced just as a scaling factor, so that we write that the partial derivatives of our perturbation density plus the gradient of the perturbation velocity field scaled with the mean density. Add up to zero. This leaves us with the fourth equation, the equation of state, where we now just use a polytropic equation of state that is independent of t, so that we can write here that the scaled pressure equals the scaled density to the power of our polytropic coefficient, or we can express this in units of the in terms of the sound speed, where the sound speed equals to gamma times the ratio of the pressure to the density. So we can write that 1 plus P1 over P0 equals 1 plus the ratio of rho 1 over rho 0 to the power of gamma. Can also use this with the pressure term in the Navier-Stokes so that the gradient of P1 is the partial derivative of the pressure with respect to the density times the gradient of the perturbation density. This can be written as sound speed squared times the gradient of rho 1. Because here the sound speed squared is given by the ratio of P0 over rho 0. So, when we start with our simplified Navier-Stokes equation, the gradient of the gravitational potential was written as minus the partial derivative of V1 minus the pressure term that we write now as Cs squared over rho naught times the gradient of the perturbation density. Now we take the divergence of the whole equation and multiply with rho naught. So we can write here on the left-hand side, the divergence turns into the Laplace operator of the gravitational potential. And then we have here on the right-hand side, the rho naught times then the divergence of the velocity field of the perturbations, the velocity gradient, minus Cs squared and the Laplace of the density 1. So we can put this now into our Poisson equation. So we can replace this into our left-hand side here of the Poisson equation so that we can write 4 pi gravitational constant times mean density times perturbation density equals rho naught, and then the partial derivative with respect to the time of the divergence of the velocity minus C squared Laplacian of the density field. So we can exchange the time and the spatial derivatives, and which means we can use the continuity equation and substitute this so that the second temporal derivative of our perturbation density equals minus rho naught, and then the partial derivative of the divergence of our perturbation. So this was the status here. We have now the transformed Poisson equation, the modified continuity equation, And when we now substitute the V1 term, we get here the second derivative of the density 1 with respect to the time as Cs squared Laplace of density 1 plus 4 pi g density 0 times density 1. And what we have here is now a equation that is a wave equation. We have the second time derivative on the left-hand side and the second spatial derivative on the right-hand side, plus some constant term here. And this constitutes a wave equation for our perturbation density rho 1. To solve this, we make a wave ansatz, which means we write the density rho 1 as a wave, so some constant times an exponential of I times then k vector times location vector r minus omega t. Here k is the wave vector that describes the direction in which our wave is traveling. R is the location vector, of course, and omega is the circular frequency of our wave. And the full solution is then given by the superposition of all possible waves. Our amplitude C is finally determined by our boundary conditions. When we put this ansatz into our wave equation, what we find is minus omega squared times rho 1 equals minus Cs squared times k squared times density 1 plus 4 pi g density 0 times density 1. And this is a dispersion relation that relates how the time evolution and the spatial evolution of these waves are connected. We can simplify this by dividing by omega 1 so that the full simplified dispersion relation omega squared is given by the sound speed squared times the k vector squared minus 4 pi g times our mean density. So this is the final dispersion relation that describes how the wave number k and the frequency are related. We are looking at, when we look at this dispersion relation, we see that the wave vector k occurs only squared. So this is now a scalar, which means that the actual direction vanishes of our wave, which means that we have an isotropic propagation, and that it only depends on the norm of our vector k. So we know that our perturbation can be described by a wave equation, that it behaves like waves, so we can apply all our knowledge of how waves behave, to the problem here. And what we find for any wave is that we have a phase velocity, v phi, that is given by omega divided by k. And we have a group velocity, vg, that is given by the derivative of omega with respect to the wave number. And this is, yes, yes, squared times k times omega. So, we have here a different k dependence for the phase velocity and the group velocity. In this figure here, I show how the velocities depend on the wave number, which is given here on the x-axis. We have the phase velocity here as black curve and the group velocity as blue curve. They behave differently as a function of k. And we can look at the limiting cases when our k is large, so we are here, then our phase and our group velocity are about equal. Large k's means small wavelengths, small spatial lengths of our perturbation. And in this case, we have no dispersion of the waves because our combination of individual wavelengths, our group, our wave packages moves with all with the same velocity. And we find that they move at the sound speed, because here in this view graph, the y-axis is normalized to the sound speed, which means we find the behavior of classical sound waves. So for the ideal gas, our sound speed is the thermal velocity and is given by Cs equals the square root of gamma times Kb, Boltzmann constant, times the temperature divided by the mean molecular weight. So it's only given by the temperature. Gravitation doesn't play any role anymore. And we find that indeed sound is a solution of the hydrodynamic equations. Because if the phase and the group velocity were not the same, any speech would become distorted while it travels, and communication would become basically impossible. So for small wavelength, we found here the sound solution. When we look at a small k, so at large wavelengths, we find a dispersive behavior, namely that our phase velocity becomes significantly smaller than the sound speed, while the group velocity becomes significantly larger than the sound speed. So the two are moving apart here in our diagram. We have a significant dispersion. And we can express the wave number where this divergence occurs we call it the J, the Jeans wave number, and this is at the square root of 4 pi G rho naught divided over the sound speed squared. This is here. And as you see from this graph here, perturbations with smaller wave numbers than the Jeans wave number, so with larger wave length, with larger spatial scales, they cannot propagate, which means they remain where they are. They remain localized. They cannot move through our medium, which means that only short wavelengths perturbations that we were looking at here, this range, propagate as sound waves, while the others remain localized. So, what happens now when we have these large perturbations below the Jeans wave number? So here we have again our dispersion relation, and you see that the Jeans number is exactly given by where at what k do the left and the right term here become equal. If k becomes smaller, then our circular frequency omega becomes imaginary, because this is again here given as omega squared. And for k smaller than the Jeans wave number, the right-hand side becomes negative. So this, we have the square root of negative. When we look at our wave ansatz for our perturbation, then we have here this term, which is now a imaginary, a complex number, which is multiplied with the I here, which means this makes the product real. So our wave equation turns into omega rho 1 equals our constant C times the exponential of the temporal term. So plus minus T normalized to some time that is given by tau g times the spatial wave behavior here given by the e to the I k r term. The plus minus comes from the two possible roots of our negative omega squared, and the time scale, the tau g is I over omega. So we can write this as 1 over and then the square root of 4 pi g rho naught minus cs squared k squared. And this is 1 over Cs and then square root of the Jeans wave number minus k squared. So this term here can, if it is negative, lead to an exponential damping of our perturbation with time, or to an exponential, so for the negative, or to an exponential growth if it's positive on a time scale tau g. So our perturbations, when they are larger than the, or then if they have a wave number that is smaller than our kj, grow on this time scale. And when we plot tau as a function of k, then we see that for infinite large waves, so when the wave number approaches zero, we have here the minimal time scale tau naught of 1 over cs square root of kj squared. And this is just 1 over the square root of 4 pi g rho naught. So here the time scale is entirely given by the gravitational pull of our mean density medium. The closer we get to a ratio of k over kj of 1, the higher this this time scale, the time will be. And since we have a general solution, the superposition of all possible modes, the fastest growing contribution, those with the smallest k, will win and therefore dominate the behavior of the structure. So the dominant mode is for the largest waves, and k0 represents infinitely extended perturbations. So this practically means that changing the overall densities are the fastest possible density changes that are there. And as a consequence, any extended medium is automatically gravitational unstable, because just its overall mean configuration constitutes the fastest possible extending perturbation. So any extended medium will automatically collapse or disperse into subregions. And this can only be stabilized through some external contributions, through some boundary conditions, for example, by adding some external pressure or by limiting our medium to some finite infinite size. So as a critical size, we can say that as the moment we have a medium that is larger than given by this limiting case of kj, it will become gravitational unstable. So if we prohibit anything that is larger than given by the kj, we will have a stable configuration. If k may become smaller than kj, we will have a collapse of the medium. We will have a gravitational instability. And we can, of course, express this also in spatial scales by converting our k to the wavelength, so by division of 2 pi over k. This gives the gene's length, and this is the square root of pi times c squared over g times the mean density. This is the so-called gene's length. Any structure with an L larger than Lj are automatically gravitational unstable and will collapse. Assuming a constant density, as we did in the beginning, we can compute from this also the corresponding masses, limiting masses, so the gene's mass, just by assuming a spherical sphere of the size Lj with a density rho naught. So the mass is the integral, so 4 pi divided by 3, density 0, and then Lj half to the power of 3, because Lj is basically the diameter of our structure. And this can also be written as pi divided by 6 times pi over g to the power of 3 half times Cs to the power of 3 divided by the square root of our mean density. And the sound speed depends on the thermodynamics of the gas, and for the ideal gas this can be also be expressed in units of our polytropic coefficient. So we have pi over 6, pi over 6 times gamma, and then here pi kb over g, and the molecular weight to the power of 3 half, and then 3 t to the power of 3 half divided by the density square root. This is the so-called gene's mass. So if we have a molecular cloud with a mass smaller than the gene's mass, it will not be gravitationally unstable, it will not collapse. The dependence on the temperature here tells us that the gene's mass grows with temperature. So if our cloud is hot, we need a higher mass for it to collapse. That is because the higher temperature creates a higher pressure that acts against the gravitation. The density behavior here tells us that if we have a denser cloud, its gene's mass is lower. So we need a lower mass for it to become gravitationally unstable, and that is because a higher density increases the gravitational force and increases the gravitational pull. So when we replace our physical density here with the number densities and compare different regions, then when we look, for example, at the early universe, briefly after decoupling, we have temperatures of a couple of thousand Kelvin, 5,000 Kelvin, and densities, mass densities in the order of 100 particles per cubic centimeter. Inserting this into our formula for the gene's mass gives a gene's mass of 10,000 solar masses at a total mass of 10 to the 22 solar masses, which means the early universe was gravitationally highly unstable, and immediately it formed on the scale of 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5 solar masses, sub-volumes that were collapsing and forming galaxies and then also forming stars. When we look at interstellar clouds, diffuse clouds at a temperature of 100 Kelvin and densities of a few 10 particles per cubic centimeter, then the gene's mass is in the order of 1,000 solar masses, while those clouds are a few 10 solar masses massive, which means they are gravitationally stable against their own gravity. And when we look at giant molecular clouds that may have temperatures of only 10 Kelvin, 10 to 30 Kelvin, and densities in the thousands, here the gene's mass is in the regime of a few 10 solar masses, while the clouds have observed masses of thousands, which means giant molecular clouds are all basically gravitationally instable. As a consequence, they all should immediately collapse and form stars, which means that we shouldn't be able to observe any because they all converted their gas into stars. This is not true. The Milky Way is filled with giant molecular clouds. All other galaxies where we can observe this, we observe that we find in giant molecular clouds there. So we need some additional forces, we need some additional effects that stabilize these giant molecular clouds against collapse, and maybe also processes that that increase again the density of gas in the interstellar medium, for example, by re-injecting particles from stars, for example, into clouds. But this is more topic of the star formation lecture.